and doing the work that no one else seems to be ready to do, but that we're willing to sacrifice for it. And it's that shared sacrifice and creating new friends and you know, just walking and talking 100 miles about really, really boring issues that everyone is just so enlightened about. I mean, God, where else would you be able to just talk with anybody in the line about gift bans? Who would stay up late, you know, going through the bill, the gift ban bill, and, you know, just trying to shoot holes in it? I mean, like, it's incredible what happens when you get like-minded people into a room and march 100 miles. Magical things happen. And no matter what happens in Harrisburg, I mean, at least for me, I'm going to bring this back to Boston and make sure that, you know, the story gets out and really just, you know, try and spread the word and hold that with me as I move forward.
Well, as a journalist, we don't really have those moments of joy in the same way, because we're not working for change in as direct a way. So sure, we have joy about personal accomplishments, or we have a big story that a lot of people see. And I've certainly taken joy from being able to tell the stories of people who wouldn't otherwise have a way to do that. But they're often bad stories. They're often stories about people not being allowed to vote or being discriminated against in some way. So I don't think of it in quite the same way. But I wanted to ask a question, sort of a practical question that I think either Carol or Representative Vitali could answer about the state maps. And I know that they rigged the congressional maps pretty good. And I think it ended up, you know, Democrats got more votes in, I think I'm thinking of the 2012 election, but Republicans got 13 out of 18 congressional seats. I assume they rigged the state maps pretty good too, but what is the scale of the whole there, and is it possible for Democrats to win back either House, or do they control one of the Houses? Sorry, I should know that, but I live in New York, I'm not from New York.
So it's really bad. A study came out just this past week, which you all need to go and read, from the Brennan Center for Justice. It's called Extreme Maps, and it takes the three current best standards for gerrymandering, which one is something mean media, there's the efficiency gap, and I can't remember the other one. They're still trying to find the right name, but basically if you run a million simulated maps and you do a bell curve, where does this fall on that bell curve? So there's three different standards that are being tested out in the courts and in other places. By those three standards, Pennsylvania is the worst on two of them, and it is just a hair less than the worst on the third. So we have the wonderful privilege of being among the absolute worst gerrymandered states in the country. So in our congressional maps, the Republicans managed to pull five. We have 18 seats. The Republicans have 13 out of 18. So they've said they're five beyond what they ought to have. And we've heard that, well, the state maps are not as bad. We put an app on our website where if you really drill in and look at those maps, you see just amazing, weird, crazy nonsense. And so I went to the precinct in Phoenixville last fall where we had to give out two different ballots because the precinct had been divided into separate House districts. So they actually had, within that one precinct, they had two different districts. And if you look at the demographics of those neighborhoods, you can see exactly what's going on. The poorer neighborhoods are being cracked out into the neighborhoods around them. Those people have absolutely no voice. Last week I was at a conference for people who work with our smaller urban cities around the state, and all of those smaller urban cities are deeply harmed by the fact that they have no representation, because they're all cracked out into the rural and suburban
communities around them. What do you mean by cracked out?
So cracked out. So you take a community which by rights should have its own state senator, its own state representative. You take those communities and you splinter them out as much as you need to do to make sure, if it was a community like this that would probably have a Democrat who was really focusing on the needs of that one urban area, well, if you draw your maps properly, you can end up with four state senators, none of whom live in your community, none of whom are thinking about your community, and they're thinking about other stuff. So like Reading, if you look at your congressional district, your district 16, you're voting with Amish farmers, but that drilled down into your state senate districts, your state house districts, the same thing is going on. You're broken out into pieces, and anywhere you see those crazy squiggles going on, those are Pennsylvania urban, small urban communities that are being cracked out into the communities around them. Or if you see these, you know, districts kind of wandering over mountains and over rivers, as you do, it's to make sure that the urban demographics are not dense enough to get the representation that they deserve. But then that plays out in all kinds of economic ways, zoning laws, regulations for small cities. You go down the list of what a small city like Allentown's not that small, but Allentown, I was at last week had a panel of mayors who were just talking about the problems that they face trying to get economic renewal in their cities, and they just started just talking about gerrymandering, the fact that they have no representation, the fact that there's nobody in Harrisburg who is listening to them and advocating for the kind of changes that they need to have a functional, thriving economy. It's very, very bad.
So again, just to ask, because I know that there are some states where under the current maps, there's no realistic chance of Democrats regaining control. Is that the case in Pennsylvania until 2020, until their new maps drop?
I want to reframe that question and make it Pennsylvania specific. Carol, can you talk about who holds the power of redistricting? Who holds the state map and who holds the congressional map and what that standoff looks like right now? And then this will kind of get at how the pendulum can swing back and forth.
Pennsylvania has a lot of really, really interesting dynamics going on right now, which I sometimes say I feel like I'm trying to learn to ride a surfboard in front of a tsunami and play three-dimensional chess at the same time, because that's what it is. So the congressional map is just passed as a piece of legislation by our legislature. The state maps, Senate maps, are passed by that five-person commission. Currently, the fifth person of that commission is chosen by the state Supreme Court, if they can't agree. Our current state Supreme Court is Democratic, which means that in the next round of redrawing, the state maps will be drawn by Democrats. So that is a very interesting piece of information that we are hoping to leverage. There's another piece, though. You ask, is there any way that this would change before the next mapping? There's going to be a lawsuit. If you look at the efficiency gap standard put out by Stephanopoulos and McGee, the point of their study was to say that there are states that are litigating that by rights are not that bad. And there are states that should be litigating that are not doing that. Their initial study said the state that should, they didn't say it quite this way, but if you read their study carefully and you look at their graphics, basically what they're saying is the number one state to litigate congressional district maps is Pennsylvania. So when Wisconsin's case went forward last November, a number of us who have been watching this carefully said, this is something that needs to be addressed. So there has been a lawsuit in the works since then. Pennsylvania is a very vengeful state, so there are quite a few pro bono law firms that reached out to us. The pro bono arms of the law firms reached out to us and said, who is working on this? We would love to get involved. This is really important. This is really a ground-changing opportunity to litigate on partisan gerrymandering. It's very bad in Pennsylvania, and we think we could have a really good case. In all those cases, the partners, when asked to approve the lawsuit, said, they will go after us. It will cost us, and we can't do it. So a national law firm finally stepped in and said, the law firm that litigated the voter ID law, I can't name them because I'm not allowed to at this point, but that law firm stepped up and said, we will take this on. So they are in the process of putting a case together. They're working with the Public Interest Law Center. We're expecting to see a lawsuit very, very soon. And if it moves forward quickly, there could be a new map in place before the 2020 redistricting. But there's a lot of leverage going on. The fact that there's a Democratic Supreme Court, the fact that there's a lot of voters very angry. What we watched in the Erie area, where Democrats voted for Trump, there are voters across the state saying, "We are really sick of the party ignoring us. Whatever that party is, they assume they've got it wrapped up. They tell us who to vote for." We had 86% of our races, legislative races, in the last round had no opposition in the primary. 50% had no opposition at the General Assembly. Voters are very angry about that. And so voters across the state are basically saying, we're tired of you telling us who our representative is, and we will field new candidates, and we will support this reform. So I mentioned we've had at least 140 informational meetings since January. We've had over 9,000 people show up at those meetings. We have so many volunteers across the state passionate about doing something about this because they feel like they're being ignored, and they realize the reason they're ignored is because the maps are drawn in a way that nobody needs to listen to.
Carol or Representative Vitali, I'd like to just kind of follow up on the current, you know, who holds the maps in Harrisburg and how they wield that power. We've seen in our lobbying in the last few weeks a flip-flop from Senate Democratic leadership, particularly Minority Leader Costa. And I would just like for you to maybe, I know you have some thoughts on that flip-flop. Let me honor this question. What we've noticed in our lobbying is that the main divide is not necessarily party to party, but membership and leadership in Harrisburg. And that the leadership uses gerrymandering as a weapon against the membership sometimes as a form of control. And so we've seen a flip-flop from Senate Democrats, and because they hold, oh, I'll let you tell the story.
What I've seen from the start is leadership on both sides basically saying what we have is accountable government, it works fine, nobody needs to change it. That was number one. Number two then was Democrats saying, well, really, congressional districts are very, very, very bad, but the state house districts are very, very, very good. That's how they manage their control. So if you would help us change the congressional districts, we would be very appreciative, but no way in the world ever will you change the way that the state districts are drawn. So that's kind of what we've heard from the Democratic leadership. The Republican leadership is just ignoring us completely. What's interesting though is if there are Republicans in leadership who want to run for statewide office, they're going to have to change their tune very quickly because they're not going to go anywhere unless they notice that there are voters. There are voters, and they're not going to win without getting a good handful of those voters to vote for them. So, I mean, there's lots of pressure points, there's lots of interesting conversation, and it's not Republican against Democrat. We have quite a few Republicans who have signed on to HB 722, three who have signed on to SB 22, and lots of really good conversations still taking place. Lots of people asking good questions, looking at bills, thinking about them, wondering about. Can they, what really breaks my heart, we were working very hard to get a Republican primary sponsor for HB 722. We had good conversations and people said, that's like putting a bullseye on your back. It saddens me that people will not do what they know is the right thing to do because they are afraid of retribution from their leadership. To me, that is one of the most heartbreaking things I've encountered, very cynical nature of the leadership and the fear that rank and file legislators have of their leadership. I find that really appalling.
And what we've seen in meetings, especially with Minority Leader Dermody's office, is that the Democratic leadership has this very unfeasible plan of using the state legislative map to then swing the congressional map by 2032 and gain control of both maps. And of course, this depends on winning a few key governor's races. It's not a very feasible plan, but it's the leadership at all costs trying to retain that power is what it feels like. So with that, would anybody like to say anything else before we open it up to questions?
Yeah, I mean, one thing is that there's this dynamic between rank and file and leadership in that rank and file with regard to the state house lines puts, they don't want to lose the next election, so there's pressure to make sure their seats are safe. I was there when they voted on the congressional plan, you know, 10 or so years ago, and the reality is it was a terrible district, and I live in the 7th congressional district, and I actually, someone described it as like, it looks like spin art. It's so spirally. You know, to give you an example, it starts in Upper Derby, and it comes out here to Ole in Mennonite country. Are we near Ole? It goes from Upper Derby to Ole. It goes down to the Delaware border. It goes to the foot of Lancaster. And it's a terrible secret that decimated the 7th congressional district. And what I think the problem was they did it with some Democrats too. You had some, for example, Congressman Brady was working behind the scenes to get a district that was both safe for him and racially white enough for him to win. And he was going into our caucus. And if you look at that vote count, people like Marco Davidson and Mark Cohen and Bill Keller, Democrats, voted for that thing. And we actually had a lawsuit all set to go on that. We had witnesses, we had an alternative plan. We had legal women voters as one of our plaintiffs. We had it ready to go, and we could not. The lawyer kind of mysteriously refused to file it. He was a public interest lawyer in Westchester, who I will not forget to this day, but I won't mention his name. I have a feeling somebody got to him. But we went to lawyer after lawyer, interest group after interest group, to see if they would do it. But no one would take it. No one would take it pro bono. We learned a very valuable lesson about having money and the power it gives you. But I think some of those, and the problem you run into is the leading case then, perhaps still now, is the Veith case, where the court basically said, you know, we will not overturn what a state does for political reasons. We'll do it for racial reasons and other reasons, but not political reasons, because there's not a real ready remedy available for that. So that's the problem. I think that's the problem we run into with regard to the congressional lines. The big difference, and you're right, the congressional lines are done just like a bill. The difference then was it was a Republican Senate, Republican House, Republican governor. Now, at least next time around, if we can keep Wolf in there, we'll have a seat at the table. They will not be able to sort of write their own sort of congressional redistricting map. And the same thing is with regard to the issue, as you mentioned, the state lines. That actually was appealed to the state Supreme Court, and they found the plan unconstitutional. They sent it back, and they modified it. They modified it a bit. And the problem there was that the neutral, Judge McKeown, wasn't actually a neutral at all. He was an ex-Florida County District Attorney. He was actually my moot court professor in law school, but didn't stop him from messing up my district. So the difference this year is that if you can't decide on the neutral, as you mentioned, it goes up to the Supreme Court, who decides that. In this case, it would be the Pennsylvania Democratic Supreme Court.
The Vitali case that you mentioned, as you know, I'm sure the Supreme Court has taken another gerrymandered case, the Whitford case from Wisconsin, and could issue a ruling that you know, says courts can weigh in on these partisan gerrymandering even when there isn't a racial bias claim. So it depends on Anthony Kennedy, I guess, like most of these cases do, but we could see a decision that you know, changes that precedent and would make it a lot easier to bring cases against these extreme partisan gerrymanders.
I just want to say something very quickly that, you know, the word gerrymander comes from the governor of Massachusetts in 1890.
12, Gary, Eldridge Gary. And so a lot of people say that gerrymandering has been around, you know, for 200 years, what's the problem? You know, the thing is that when you have the intersection of big money, which has been opened up, not just from Citizens United, a long way back in 1976, but really this proliferation of outside money coming to terms or then intersecting with the increase of technology over the years. I mean, thinking about the difference between technology in the year 2000 and 2010, you know, there was no Twitter, there was no YouTube, you know, cell phones were flip phones. You know, I mean, imagine the way in which technology has advanced. So too is the ability to use computers to make maps increased exponentially. In the same way, technology increases exponentially across the board. So what you find in 2010 and in 2020 is that we're playing with nukes. We're playing with increased money, the ability of money to influence state elections, the increased technology, and then also the ability to buy metadata. You know, you hear about metadata a lot with the NSA and all that stuff, but a lot of metadata is available to buy. What you watch on Amazon, what you buy on Amazon, what you watch on Netflix, what websites you look at, all this stuff is available to anybody with money. So you add all of those things together, and you have maps that break the system. You can project the way populations will move over 10 years, and the district is impenetrable. So this issue has been around, but it's taken a real toll for the worse in terms of where it is today. It's not the same gerrymandering it was. And this is why it's so important. You can't just play an arms race like, you know, that like was said, like, well, if we win in 2020 and 2020, eventually we're going to get to the point where it's just not breakable. And we're already getting to a place where a lot of maps are gerrymandered to, you know, plus 8, meaning that like a certain party would have to beat, you know, it used to be surveyed, but now a certain party would have to, you know, win by 8-9 points in an already gerrymandered district. It's just impossible. I think that's kind of what Zach was getting at. You know, is it really impossible for Democrats to take back some of these seats? Probably not. You know, it's a way of manipulating the possibility of a main election or anything like that. So, it's really important to
notice. Gerrymandering absolutely has a rich history. It actually began before Eldridge Gerry. The first attempt at gerrymandering was Governor Patrick Henry of Virginia, who was trying to keep his archenemy James Madison out of Congress. And he tried to redraw the district where Madison lived in Virginia in such a way that it would keep Madison out, but he wasn't able to. He tried his hardest, but he just didn't know where people lived and who they were more likely to vote for. But as Adam said, now we have, you know, all the metadata that there is. So we really, and you know, when we look at maps, I really encourage people to go to Fair District's website and look at the maps and zoom in. You see it's block by block, sometimes it's even house by house, that it's very possible to know exactly who is more likely to vote for who. And this creates a large disconnect in Congress. Congress has an approval rating generally under 10% and a re-election rating generally over 90%. And that is gerrymandering.
Can I just say one last thing about gerrymandering? Not to get too bogged down in this, because I know it's only one piece of this larger thing we're talking about, which is democracy. But, you know, it's true, of course, that we're gradually getting more sophisticated technology that allows us to draw maps that gerrymander even more effectively. But I feel like we're sort of pussyfooting around the real reason why we're talking about this right now, which is that in the last round, Republicans made a concerted effort to first win control of state houses around the country. They spent more money on that than had ever been done. And then to rig the maps in those state houses in order to give themselves control, both in terms of winning congressional seats and state legislative seats. That was a very deliberate strategy enacted by Republicans starting about 2008. And you can call that sort of ordinary, very smart partisan politics, which it was, or very ruthless, or you can see it as kind of out of bounds and anti-democratic. But that was a very singular thing that happened in a much more deliberate and concerted way than had ever been done before. And that's the problem that we faced this decade, and a much more severe problem in terms of gerrymandering than we had witnessed, I think, ever before. So it's just important not to lose sight of that fact. It's not just some kind of vague trend having to do with technology is the result of a very specific political strategy enacted by one party, the Republican Party. I know this is like a bipartisan thing or whatever, but that's true.
And I'll add to that. Karl Rove said in 2010, whoever controls the map controls Congress. And Congress is supposed to be the people's house. And so that's why here in Pennsylvania we're trying to take control of the map and hand it over to the people, put it into an independent, nonpartisan commission. And when we arrive in Harrisburg on Monday, May 22nd, we are going to be reminded, our state legislature, that building, that our state capitol, is the people's house, and that it deserves to be responsive and respectful to the people. So I'd like to just open up to questions, if anybody would like to ask a question. Our gift band expert, Maddie.
Hi, thank you so much. If I can follow the rules of the White House and do a two-question, that would be great. Okay. this one is for Carol. What is the argument for and against drawing the lines based on population versus voter registration?
Voter registration. Well, it's one person, one vote, so somebody, you just caught me. My brain is just gone blank.
So if I can give a little bit.
You answer. You've obviously thought this through.
I have, but I haven't come to a concrete conclusion. And I see arguments for and against. But one could argue that in areas where the districts are drawn based on population alone, and you have a particularly inactive group of people, that would work against a legislator being elected or re-elected versus a district that is drawn based on super voters, but again, disenfranchising, you know, a portion of the population. I'm just curious to hear your opinion.
Think about who's registered to vote. I mean, registered to vote is, I mean, it's about as linear as it gets in terms of class, socioeconomic status. That the more money you have, the more likely you are to register to vote. So if you do it based on registered voters, you're going down upper class bias. If you do it on population size, you're going to have a much more equal distribution of the voter population. You know, not on, you know, give the extra way to people more money.
Some states have suggested when you do actually is eligible voters, not registered.
Exactly. And that fixes any sort of, you know, potential bias of socioeconomic status, race-based, gender, all that stuff. It just gets distorted when you add these additional barriers.
Well, still, if you're doing, you know, there was this lawsuit that reached the Supreme Court where a group of conservatives in Texas was arguing that constitutionally you're only allowed to do it by eligible voters, not by population. And the Supreme Court said, no, that's not the case. You can do it by population. They didn't go so far as to say you have to do it by population. So it seems open right now as to which states choose. But what's very clear is that if you choose to do it by eligible voters, you're disenfranchising areas with large numbers of immigrants. And areas with families with kids who are not eligible voters. And so what the people opposing that lawsuit argued was even if you're not an eligible voter, you deserve representation. And it's clear that the effect of not giving them representation would not be positive for, I think, the values and the people that most of us as progressives, if I can sort of use that term for most people in this room, care about.
Okay. Throw in there prison gerrymandering, though, and that becomes very complicated. So I very much try to avoid that particular question because it's a very tricky one. And in Pennsylvania, we have a real problem with prison gerrymandering. And we've tried to. Yeah, so prison gerrymandering is right now the Census Bureau counts incarcerated people in the place where they're incarcerated in, by Pennsylvania law, they should be counted in their home communities. Pennsylvania law says that, but Pennsylvania just accepts the Census Bureau numbers. I believe there are 7 House districts that would not exist. They would not have adequate numbers to exist if they did not have the numbers that they are given from communities where the incarcerated people would be counted if they were counted in their own community. So in other words, prison gerrymandering takes voting power